Hallelujah. You can be seated. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We're reading here in 2 Kings 8. I want to make some references back to the fourth chapter of 2 Kings. As we read here in the eighth chapter of 2 Kings, we're reading is about Elisha. And if you look actually in this story, it's kind of funny how it almost seems like this story is chronologically out of order with some of the things that's already took place. But it's giving reference back here with this particular woman that we are familiar with from the fourth chapter. And we find that Elisha, along his journey, we know that he was servant unto Elijah. And when Elijah was getting ready to go, he says, follow me. He said, what is it that you're wanting? And he said, when you leave, I want a double portion of your spirit. So we know that Elijah did many miracles, and we read in the Word of God, and we look at Elisha, at how mightily and how powerfully God used him. So we find that Elisha, the man of God, as he would come through Shunem, that there was a woman that the Bible talks about in the fourth chapter, says that it calls her a great woman. And it speaks to her character and about her. And it said that when the man of God would come through the town, that she encouraged him, and she kind of drew him in, wanting to feed him and to break bread with him. And he did. He come in, and he ate with them and had some food. And not just once, but every time he come by, they encouraged him, come by and eat with us. Now, I don't know about y'all, but that's my kind of people. That every time you come by, they said, hey, man, come on in here. I got some good vittles for you. That's my kind of folks. And I believe Elisha began to, when he would head that direction anytime he was traveling, if he was probably anywhere near Shunem, he probably was like, I'm going to slip by this woman's house because, you know, she got them good cornbread and them good beans and taters and whatever they was having. I don't know. But, you know, when it says breaking bread, I'd like to think about some good old sweet cornbread. It's one of my favorites. Y'all may not like it. Some people like traditional, but whatever it was, they began to have a relationship and a friendship between this lady, and she seen something in him. As he begins to go forth many times, she went to her husband, and she's like, you know, husband, I think we need to make a room for this great man of God. I think we should, when he comes, that he not just stop for a meal, but that maybe he could study and spend the night and have a place. And if you look at where the words that they use, it talks about like a loft, or maybe they converted an attic into a room. I'm not sure exactly how they did it, but it was enough that we know the Bible says he had a bed and a place for a lamp and a place for him to read upon, and a little room, a loft for him, a special place dedicated to. No one was using it but him, and only when he come through. And as he was enjoying in this room and sitting in this room, he began to ponder and think, man, this woman has done so many things. I want to repay some of this kindness to her. And he sends his servant. He says, you know, ask her what it is she wants. What is she, you know, can I speak before the king for you? How about over the captain of the armies? You know, his position he was in, he had open a door to be able to be in the man of God, to be able to speak with these high. And she's like, no, I'm good. I dwell amongst my own people. We find this woman to say something that most of us have a hard time. She was basically saying, I'm content. I don't need to go before the king or the president. Someone was to ask me if I want to sit down with the president. I have no need to go in to Washington to sit down with the president. I mean, it would be a great honor, whatever, but I'm content amongst my peers and my people. I'm happy where I'm at. And she was saying, you know what, I don't need that. So the man of God said, She goes away, and he gets to talking to Gehazi, his servant, again. And he said, what is it that we could do? And Gehazi said, well, you know, her husband, he's old. And if you look at the translation where the word is great, it gives reference that she is probably older herself. And you look at this life, and he says, he's old, and she don't have any children. She don't have a son. And the man of God says, there we go. Go get her. Bring her. And she stood in the door, and he says, according to the word of God, by this time next year, you're going to have a child. And she's like, oh, nay, no, don't lie to me, man of God. Please don't. And I want you to understand something. During this time frame of life, if a woman had not bear her husband a child, especially a male child, to pass on his name, it was considered a great blight upon her, like she's done something wrong, or that God's cursings were upon her. But see, this is a great woman. This is a woman that was notable. She was known probably for her kindness. It's very obvious that you look at how she treated the man of God, this kindness and this goodness that was in this woman. Everyone knew that she wasn't a bad person, but why did she not have children? Doesn't go a whole lot into it. I look at Hannah when she didn't have a child, and she was so miserable and just sickened, and she went before the Lord and cried and groaning until she had so many tears that she cried before the Lord, wanting a child. And she even said, "Lord, I'll give my child back to you." And we know that's where Samuel come from. We look at Abraham and his wife, and she was prophesied to have a child, but year after year after year after year, no son. And it grieved her so much that she told her husband to go with my servant and have a child with her, and that'll be like a child from me. We know in this time frame that this woman, there was no doubt she wanted a child. Why didn't she ask for one? She obviously wanted one when the man of God said, "What would you like?" She's like, "I'm good." Why didn't she speak up and ask for it herself? And then when he offers it to her, she's so... Don't lie to me. You know, I believe, Sister Barbara, sometimes we have things that's so deep inside of us that after so long, we kind of give up hope. We kind of resolve in our mind that certain things will just never happen. It won't happen for me. And maybe, you know, maybe that's why she was trying to be so good in other areas that no one would think there was something wrong with her, or something was bad wrong. It's hard to say exactly where her mental state was. But all I know is when the Lord began to give this offer to her, she was a little, don't lie to me. Don't do this to me. And then all of a sudden, the Bible, according to the time of the season, the next year, sure enough, she had conceived. Sure enough, she had a child. And some time goes on. The child gets older and is working out in the field. And one day he began to say, "Oh, my head. And they sent the servants to take him to his mother. And she sits down with him on her lap. And the Bible said till noontime. And all of a sudden, he died. This child died. So what do we do sometimes when we have a situation where maybe you haven't done anything wrong? You've not necessarily messed up. You've not went really, you know, into such an area that it makes things so confusing that make you, sometimes it makes you want to say, "God, why?" And that's what I want to minister to you today on. Why, God? Why me? Why now? These are the things that sometimes we find in our lives. It doesn't necessarily mean that when things go wrong in your life that you're in the depths of sin. Doesn't mean you've messed up, you've done anything necessarily bad wrong. But sometimes things just happen, Brother Bill, and unexplainable bad things. And we find this mother with this child that she wanted desperately, didn't have enough courage to even ask for. And then she received it and he died. We also find in this story that this same mother sent word to her husband that I need a donkey, I need a mule, and I need one of the servants to take me. I'm going to see the man of God. And he's like, "Well, it's not the Sabbath or new moon. Why are you going?" She said, "It's all well. It's all good. It's all well." She didn't tell him that her little boy was dead. She was on a mission. She told the servant, she said, "You ride on and you ride hard. Don't worry about me. Don't slow down for me unless I tell you, in case it got too bad." She was on a mission, and they rode hard until they got to the man of God. And the man of God was waiting, and he looked. He's seen her coming, and he's like, "Why, Lord, what's going on? You've not told me what's going on." And she comes in. She falls to his feet. And she says, "Why? I didn't ask for him, but why is God taking him from me now? I didn't ask, and you give him to me anyway. I was afraid that something like this would happen." Can I tell you that sometimes we have things that we dream and that we long for. We want change in our life. There's certain things that we want, good things. And we become sometimes so afraid to ask that because we're afraid that surely something good couldn't happen to me. Look at my past, or look where I come from, or look at the things that I've endured, or whatever the situation. And sometimes, some people just have no problem asking. It's gimme, gimme, gimme. But you know, some folks, we're just afraid to ask because sometimes my good things don't last. I've known people that they have been afraid of a relationship, and they start getting into a dating relationship, and things start getting so good, and they sabotage it. It's better to end it now so I'm not hurt. I feel like that's where this woman was when it comes to a child. I believe this was the greatest desire of her heart, was to have a child. She was just afraid something would go wrong, something would happen, and she would be heartbroken. And sure enough, in the midst of her life, this little boy died. And she stood before the man of God, and she's asking, why? I didn't ask for him. You asked me what I wanted. I didn't say I wanted a child. You told me I was going to get him. I got him now. I loved him, and I've held him, and he quit breathing in my arms. But man of God, I'm going to tell you where he's sitting at. He's sitting on the bed that I made for you. That my husband, that we, this place that we put special for you, this place that was dedicated for you. See, the problem is that sometimes in our life, we don't have something to fall back on. We can't even, how can we contend with things that happen in our life when we live so frivolously and we live so haphazardly that we don't invest in time in God, invest in the relationship of God, invest in the fellowship of God, making more room so you can be there more often, God. I want to have more time with you, not less time with you. She said, husband, I don't want to just have dinner with the man of God. That's the only way they felt the presence of God was through the ministry. Until Jesus come and died on the cross, we didn't get to feel. Everyone didn't feel it. No one got close except for the ministry, the prophets, and the priests. And the rest of us just had to believe, and we just had to obey. And they did things out of obligation and out of command and not out of love. So all that she could do to be closer to God was to build something with the man of God, a friendship, a relationship, even a structure in their home. Because she had something to build on, she had a place to put that dead child. She put him in the man of God's bed. And she didn't tell anybody what was going on. And she went, and he sent his servant. He said, take my staff. This is just kind of almost comical things that happen, but who knows? Sometimes it's the most unusual things that create faith. He said, go take and put my staff right ahead of us. This man of God's like, I can't ride as fast as Gehazi could ride by himself with this woman. She's already rode out here beaten along the path. He said, you ride hard and you don't talk to anybody. If someone greets you, you don't even speak to them. You keep going, and when you get there, you lay my staff upon the face of this child. And when the man of God got there, he began to seek the Lord for this child. He began to do everything he knew to do. And you know what? Nothing happened. He even got face to face, mouth to mouth, eye to eye, hand to hand, laid his body upon this child. Even so long, not the first time, but even the second time, till his skin began to get warm. And all of a sudden, he began to sneeze. And life come back into this little fella. And you know what happened? That mama's fears, all of these things, everything come to pass. Can I tell you what happened in her that day? I'll tell you exactly what happened to her. She had faith put in action, and she seen her miracle go from death unto life, and there was something put inside of her that she would never, ever, ever have to doubt God's word. She would never doubt his feeling toward her. She would never doubt the word that would come in direction. Because we find not long after this, we're reading in the scripture where we started in that 8th chapter. And the man of God tells this woman that's been kind to him. This man of God tells this woman that has been good to him, that he has watched this child. Now, Gehazi has watched all this, the servant. But the man of God has watched this little boy grow. He's watched him go from death unto life. You're talking about a relationship. You're talking about a relationship. When you watch someone go from death unto life, you're talking about a relationship. People wonder why I'm so crazy the way I am. Because I went from death unto life. I went from not spiritually being alive to spiritually living. And a relationship was created inside of me, unexplainable. So when the Lord spoke to Elisha and said, there's fixing to be a famine in the land, who do you think Elisha thought of first? The one that was in his relationship close circle with. I look back at Abraham when the Lord was going to destroy Sodom. And the Lord said, can I withhold any good? Can I withhold what I'm going to do from my servant? Let me tell him what's fixing to happen, because he's got family in Sodom. And give an opportunity for him to plead with the Lord and to plead for mercy for this. He said, I'm going to tell him what. Can I tell you that when you create an environment with God, when you make room for God in your household, when you want more than just a dinner every now and then, just a little bit of breaking bread with the Lord, when you make a place for him to live inside your home, you make a place for him to lay down and to be there. I'm talking about spiritually. It takes more than a Sunday service. It takes more than feeling the presence of God and get a little goosebumps when we sing Kumbaya. It takes more. We got to make a place of residence for God in our home. So that when that baby's sick, that we have a place to bring, go before the Lord, a place dedicated, that we, God can hear our prayer. That when things are going to happen amongst the area, the nation, your land, that you hear that voice of warning. So when Elijah heard the Lord say, I'm going to bring a famine, the Lord, Elijah said, I got to tell this little Shunammite woman. She's already been through enough. Lord knows she can't watch that little boy die of a famine. Because I want you to understand something. They're all inside of Samaria. Might have been some distance between them, but they're all on the end. They're all inside of this area. And the Lord tells Elisha just what he's about to do. And Elisha's relationship with her, he says, listen, you got to go. We already know she loved where she lived, because when she was offered everything, she said, I dwell among my people. I'm good. I don't need anything. She was happy with where she lived. She was happy with the farm that they had, the land that they had, the husband she had, her son. She was content with everything that she had. But when the man of God come by and begin to give warning, listen, God said there's going to be a famine. Can I tell you that she listened to him? Why? Because when all hell broke loose in her life, when everything fell apart, she had a relationship and she seen God move, work, and do a miracle so that when the next thing come, she knew that God was going to be faithful. Can I tell you that sometimes we look at the Lord and we say, God? Why are these things happening? God, why is this happening? I didn't ask for this. I didn't ask for that. Why do you seem to be taking things away from me, Lord? Why now, Lord, after I made a dedication unto you? Why now after I come and knelt at an altar, Lord, and I repented of my sins and I made a decision to serve you, God? Why, God? Why me? Why has this got to happen to me? What about so-and-so that's in doing this and so-and-so that's doing that? I'm trying to make change. Why, God? Can I tell you that we all have moments of weakness and we all sometimes say, why, God? Why did her little boy die? She didn't know. She didn't understand. Didn't seem to be any explanation. But all of a sudden, because of her relationship and faith, she seen him brought back to life. Time went by. So what happened the next time when things are getting better? When the next danger come along, she got a warning. And she had enough faith because she seen God move before, that she didn't stay where she was at. How many people have a warning from God, come from a man of God, preaching a word, and they refuse to move, refuse to change, refuse to do anything different than what they're doing. Refuse to build a better relationship, to build a better place, to keep God closer in heart and hand, to build a place in their home so their children could know that God is supposed to be there. I'm talking about a real place. I'm talking about something that's special and dedicated unto God, a special relationship. How many people say, I'm good? See, that's how she started off her conversation. What do you need? I'm good. I don't need anything. I'm happy. I'm content right here. Can I tell you that sometimes tragedies and things happen in our lives and we have no explanation, but all of a sudden, somehow or another, God carries us through. The miraculous takes place. And then the next time something happens, the difference is we no longer have to live in doubt, but we've already seen the miraculous happen. We've seen it change our loved ones. We've seen it. Our little girl, Christian, before she gave her life to the Lord, she was following me. Y'all know I was a no good dope head. I was in sin so deep up to my eyebrows. I was leading her the wrong path. I was getting high with my own child when she was 12 years old. She had done gotten to a high addiction, higher than weed on pills and alcohol, all the things that she was chasing and following. And when I got my life together, guess what? She didn't. And I was like, Lord, I just know after you change my life, you're going to change my family. But he didn't. I began to pray, and I began to pray. And sometimes I would say, why, God? I get these crazy phone calls, middle of the night of things happening. Why, Lord? Why, Lord? Then I start feeling like, Lord, it's because of me. It's because of what I've done. It's all of these things. And see, we get to asking these questions, and the devil jumps on our shoulder. He is so ready to feed doubt and feed just over and over that God can't or he won't or he could, but he just won't. And we're like, wow, Lord, and we don't see it. Can I tell you, this little Shunammite woman, it was a lot of years went by before she ever had a clue of what God was doing the day her little boy died. A lot of years went by. We find that not only the years went by until he was bigger when he did die and the Lord brought him back, some time had went by, but then we find that there was a famine in the land 7 years. Can I tell you that when she left that land, she left in obedience. But if we pick up reading where she come back, when she come back, guess what she had again? Nothing. Because somebody else had her land. Someone else was in her home. Someone else was gathering income from the fruit of the ground because the famine was over. The Syrians that had been surrounding Samaria, they were gone. All of a sudden, everything went in a flash of a moment from nothing to plenty. But during this time, why would she lose everything? She did exactly what the Lord told her. How could God allow this to happen in her life? That the Lord give her warning, and he'd already took her son, then he gave him back. And then all of a sudden, now she's got to leave her home and all that she has. And everything that she already loved in this life, everything she was content with, she left out a warning for 7 years because there would be a famine inside of Samaria. And then she comes back, and she's lost everything. Sometimes we say, why, God, it's unfair. Why, Lord, am I going through this? And why is this happening? Why is that happening? And we can't see the end of the line. We can't see what God is doing. Can I tell you? The Bible says we look through a glass darkly. You know, we don't know the beginning from the end. But I like what Job said. Naked I come in this world, and naked I'll leave. Blessed be the name of the Lord. He said, do I give God praise when he blessed me with good things? And do I get angry and curse him because things don't go my way? No. He said, naked I come in this world, naked I'll leave. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Say, but you don't, how? Well, he done lost all of his children through an accident, tragedy. Through storms beyond his control, he'd lost all of his wealth and all of his everything that he had. Then he lost his health and he got worse and worse and worse and worse, and he still, the Bible said, did not curse the Lord. If we could ever get to the point of quit continually saying, why, God? Why me? What did I do? Why, God? Why is this happening? Why is this happening to my children? Why is this happening here? Why is it happening there? We find that during the time that this woman comes back, she says, I'll go before the king. And I will ask him concerning my land. And as she is on the way to the king, look at your neighbor and say, God's timing. Huh? God's timing is impeccable. God's timing is perfect. God is working things out before you even have an understanding in your mind. The Bible says that the king just happened to have been talking to Gehazi, the servant of Elisha, that took that mantle and put it on the face of that child. The king just happened to have been talking to Gehazi, the man that run before them in haste to get there. The one that watched the little boy being dead when he laid it on his face and watched the little boy come out of that room alive. Just happened to have been talking to the king at the right moment. And as she's on her way to, if you look at the King James, it says to cry out for her land, for all that was lost. God was already working on her behalf before she got there. You know why? Because she'd been faithful. Because even in the midst of tragedy and trauma and all of the destruction and all the loss and all these things, she was a great woman. Not because of all the things she did, but because she didn't charge God foolishly. And she kept her faith because she'd already seen God work miracles. And as she's going before the king is asking Gehazi, tell me again all these things that Elisha has done. And he began to rehearse these miracles. And the Bible says specifically as he is telling him about her and about how God restored. If you look it up, I love it. It uses the word restored. It says as God restored this child back to life. As God restored me from a bar stool and a drug addict and all the things I was on, as he restored me back to life, I look at this story and I find myself so many times in the Word of God, how God restores the broken. He restores that's what's been destroyed. He restores the things that other people think is impossible. But see, when she left, she didn't tell her husband, your son died. She said, it's all well. She was exercising her faith that God was going to make everything right. So when she had lost everything in her life again, and she went before the king, Gehazi was saying, yeah, and I put the mantle on the little boy's face, and he began to sneeze, and he come back alive. It was amazing. And it says, as the woman come up to cry to the king, Gehazi says, as a matter of fact, there she is right there. That's the woman that I just told you the story. And the Bible says that the king called for her. She didn't have to beg for an audience with the king. God worked in her favor. Sometimes we got to get over the why me, God, and why now, God, and after all of these things, I don't understand. She had no idea when her son died and the Lord brought him back to life that it was going to be key to her future, key to getting everything back that she had lost. You don't know the hell that you're going through today and the problems you go through today, what it's going to have for you, an impact in your future, for your children's future, for your lives and for your heritage coming from here forward. Sometimes we can't see what God is doing. But I can tell you, he knows. He knows. The Bible said that the king asked her the same things that he had just talked to Gehazi talked about and said she rehearsed it. And he said, okay, he sent one of his servants. He said, you take her and you go and restore her house and her home, her land. And not just that, but all the fruit from the time she's been gone for the last 7 years, all the fruit that the land has yielded while she was gone, make sure that's been restored back to her too. Ooh, that's a good God. I told y'all about Christian. I one night I got down to an altar and I got on my face and I began to cry out to God. And I began to beg God. I've been begging and begging and begging. And one night I said, God, I know I can't do it. I've done all I know to do. I've been trying to fix it, God. I've been trying to help here and do this and do that. I turn her over to you, God. Lord, I give her to you, Lord. Whatever you could do, Lord. Whatever it takes, God. That's what I prayed. Whatever it takes. Save. And you know what? It wasn't but just a short time. She come down to that altar, had the biggest mess of makeup tears running down her face. She was crying out to God, and I'm just gonna tell her dirt. She ain't here to me to defend her. She had snot all over the pew. I mean, real crying. Real tears from down deep inside, real repentance, real change. And you know what? I'm so thankful that her babies, I have no idea just how bad a shape she was in. She was able to get her life together just before she got pregnant with my grandson. She didn't have to carry him a drug baby. He didn't have to be born addicted to anything. Just in God's right timing, I went for night after night. I said, wow, God, what's going on? Is it my fault, God? Is it what's happened? And sometimes God just wait. Because in the right time, I'll work before you. I'll go before. I'll do what you can't do. I'll do things that you just wish that you could do. All we got to do is build a relationship with him. We got to build him a place in our life. We got to see fit that when it went beyond the normal. See, it was enough you would have thought surely she was feeding him every time he come. Lord, I mean, you know, imagine one of y'all, if every time I come by your house, y'all fed me. I'd be honest, y'all, it'd get kind of expensive. Because y'all know your pastor can eat. They endured the expense. No expense too much for that man of God. But she said, it's not enough just to visit every now and then. It's not enough just to break a little bread every now and then. We need to make a place in our home for him. We need to build a place dedicated unto him. Can I tell you today, there's going to be some days of why God and Lord, why me, Lord, and all of these things. And the Lord might ask you, why not you? Why not you? And all we can do is say, Lord, I got a place and I've laid my burden in the place that I've dedicated to you. We're all going to go through some things in this life. Tragedy does not escape anybody. Heartache and pain does not escape anybody. We all go through it. Struggle and suffering, it's part of this life. Some of it's just part of the curse that we are cursed with from the beginning, from Adam and Eve. And we're going through some hard places. Lord didn't want us to go through those things, but it's the nature of sin that's ruling and raging in this land. God wants you to make a place special for him. A place special for him in your home. Hallelujah. In your personal life. More than just on Sunday here. Say, are you saying we should just do it at home and not come to church? Lord, no, that ain't what I'm saying. I'd be hunting y'all down. But they dog the bounty hunter coming. Where y'all at? Come to church. I'm that way sometimes now. It's because I love you. And I want to see God's blessings on you. And I'm praying continually, Lord God, put a fire inside of your people, Lord. Let it burn away everything, God, unlike you, God. Lord, put a fire, God, on the inside, Lord, that's unquenchable, that they have a desire, Lord, to not only serve you, God, Lord, but serve you, Lord, vigorously. Hallelujah. To make changes, to change their life, their home, everything about them, to make room for you. Come on, stand. Hallelujah. 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 Why, God? Why me, Lord? Why not you? Why not you? Hallelujah. He's called us to endure some things. Every place you look in the Word of God, you find God's people. They would go through things. They would go through valleys. They would go through low places. And God would come and rescue and do the supernatural. He would go through these things to bring people up. And they would be blessed. Job was blessed beyond measure. And the old devil even come by one day and says, well, the reason he's so blessed is because you put a hedge around him. But if you took down the fence a little bit and let me do to him a few things, he would curse you to your face. And the Lord says, have at it. You'll see. Sometimes I think the Lord has a little too much faith in us. We go through some rough places as the enemy comes against us. But he is faithful that always, in the right time, he will bring you through to a place. And you say, wow. This woman did not have to fight for her land. All she had to do was show up at the right time, at the appointed time. The man of God told her 7 years of famine, and in 7 years she came back. What happened if she come back earlier than 7 years? What happened if she didn't come back to do exactly at the appointed time? What about Naaman that went and had to dip in the river and the man of God said dip 7 times? What if he only dipped 6 times? How many of us, if we would almost do everything the Word of God says, but we don't quite fulfill what the Word of God says? What if we almost do it all and we almost get there? Is it the same result? Naaman was still dirty after the 6th time that he dipped. She not only wouldn't have got her land back, but she would have brought her child into a famine in the year 6. But at the right time, at the right obedience to God's word, life is changed. If you want God to change things in your life and you want to get to that point to where you're like, wow, God, you speak to me, you work for me, you fight for me, you go before me, make a place for him unlike any other in your life. Hallelujah. Seek him. And he'll be there. Father, I thank you for your word today, Lord Jesus. I thank you, God, for your people. Father, sometimes we get a little too carried away in life, Lord. We get a little too caught up in all that's going around, Lord. And help us, Father, to stop, Lord, and not just have fellowship with you, not just take time to break a little bread with you, Lord, but to make a place for you greater than anything in our life. Lord, to make a place for you to stay, Lord, to be at home in our life, God, that whenever you want to come by, Lord, it's open door for you. Father, let us to continue, God, Lord, to seek you. And God, I know that even now, some of us, Lord, there's some things going on in our life. And we've been asking why, Lord, and we've been asking, Lord, why me, Father, Lord, and why am I going through these things? And why now, God, after all of this and after this and after this, Lord, why are these things continue to keep coming upon me? Can I tell you that God has the answer for you? And he wants to do the miraculous in your life if you will just stay faithful. Do all you know to do and keep that relationship with him. Keep that place with him. Continually lay your burdens in the place that you have built for God in that altar of prayer. And say, Lord, I give it all to you. Lord, this altar, I lay it on the altar for you. She laid her son on the place that was dedicated to the man of God. I laid my daughter when her life was in shambles on the altar. Can I tell you today, lay your burden on the altar. And God will do the miraculous. This altar is open for prayer if you want to pray. Hallelujah.